Okay. Thank you, Mark, for videotaping at the last moment. We appreciate that. Glad to see everybody talking to each other. That's kind of nice. Sometimes that didn't always happen in the five different neighborhoods in town. So it's really nice to have you here. And it's really very, very special for me and for you to have Gordon Hall here. Yes, yes, you can clap. Gordon has contributed in his way, his own inimitable fashion, I must say, to almost every area and almost everything in this town. And he's very, very humble. He's probably going back there and crossing his eyes, saying, why am I talking this way about him? But he is one wonderful man. I'm pleased to know him, and I know most of you know him too. Take care.
Well, good evening. It's good to see all of you. This is, well, I think the fourth or fifth time that I've done this. However, one of the times I couldn't make it, Dick Ham took over for me and did a marvelous job way back then. And anyhow, so it was the year 2000. This right, is that pretty good? It was the year 2000 that we started this, so Pat Romeo actually asked me to do it, and there again, I didn't really know why, but I think she thought I knew quite a few people, so we did it that, the year 2000, and I made some notes the next day, and what it, the notes indicated, everything went well, but I had too many speakers. We had 9, I think, that evening. And so, therefore, we didn't have time for the question and answer period. So we do have 7 this evening, and now I think we have 8. I learned of another one just going to talk tonight too. So, anyhow, we have had some fun over the years. Some of the speakers that we've had, I made some notes here for myself, but we all remember Eddie Wheeler. I think it was the second year that he decided that his subjects were going to be stones. And we didn't know where that was going, how it was all going to work, but it turned out pretty good. It was quite a nice long story, but it turned out quite well. One of the ones that people really remember quite well is Lyman Fancy and Al Eisner telling about the sawmills and ice houses, and that went very well as well. And then, of course, Bill Ryer Jr. told us on that first night, the first year we did it, how he was hiding under a culvert in Haverhill Street, and hiding from his mother because she wanted him to go to the dentist. And so while he was there, he heard this terrible crash. Of course, this was July of 1942, so this terrible crash, and that was the bomber that crashed. And so he told that story that evening quite well. And also, the one that had people rolling in the aisles was Mrs. Robert Parker. And I'm gonna try to, I'll see how well I can tell it, not as well, obviously, as her, but it seems that she and Mr. Parker had a heifer that they lived on the Long Hill Farm up on Haverhill Street. And people are laughing already. And so they wanted that, introduce that heifer to a bull, and that bull was on another farm. So they decided that they would put that heifer, first off, they had a 1936 Ford, I'll call it a touring car, because it had a back seat. So they put the top down on the touring car, and they put the heifer in it. And I can picture them driving down Haverhill Street with this heifer. And so as she told the story, she started talking faster and faster because she knew what the end was going to be. So the end really was that when they, after the introduction, the heifer wouldn't get back in the truck, in the car, because they didn't want to go home. So we were left to our imagination as to why. Those are just some of the stories we heard over the years. We've had a lot of fun, honestly. We have some great speakers this evening as well, and I think that we, I think we can, we need to make sure we do have the time for a question and answer, so people are gonna, I think, have just, you know, maybe 10-minute presentations and so forth. I don't think I need to, but I will. I was gonna, because I was gonna say, for the new people in town, there were five areas in town that we all, those of us that got here in the 40s, remember. Like if you're on the playground at the only bachelor school and you're talking to somebody and say, hey, where are you from? And you might say, the Acres. Well, we didn't know what that was. We now know it was Liberty Acres. From the pond, well, that was Martin's Pond. I'm from Looney Hill. We now don't know where that is. I'm from the center, or I'm from Marblehead Street. So I think everybody here must know that, but I thought I'd say it anyway. Just so though, we're going to have speakers this evening from each area of town, those five areas. I know there are some other areas in town now, but that's then. That's now, not then. But first, we're going to hear from someone who's going to tell us about the very first building that was built in North Reading, and that's Gary Priest.
Thank you, Gordon, and welcome to everybody here. I'm glad you came. I hope we can do a good job for you and enlighten you a little bit. Before I go too far, I have to tell you, I am a real newcomer. I've only been in North Reading for 40 years. And I think everybody on the panel has got me beat by a lot. So, please bear with me. Okay, tonight I'm going to talk about the Sergeant John Flint House. Now this was supposedly, and I'm going to say some of these things, you know, like supposedly or less, because it was built before 1880 according to some of the history books. And where it was exactly located is another story. And they're not really sure where it was, but we know it was fairly close to what is known in recent years as the Downing Farm. Some of you may know of that as Harmony Farm. It was straight up, well, you go in Gowing Lane to go to that farm.
I think you mean 1680.
I'm sorry, 1680. Yeah, if I said something different, yeah.
Thank you, Bill.
Okay, all right.
1680.
Now, this is one of the first houses in North Reading, and prior to that time, the Reading line was the Ipswich River. And somewhere earlier in there, I don't know how it came about, but Andover gave, quote, this land for 2 miles north of the river to North Reading. And George Flint came up here and he built what we call a garrison house at that time. We do know that later on it was moved and attached to Joseph Gowing, okay? And the home really kind of disappeared from history. Nobody seemed to know anything about it. And then on an unfortunate incident, on January 16th, 1994, there was a fire at the Downing Farm. It was a Sunday afternoon, cold and windy day. And they saved a good portion of the house. And after the fire and all the examinations and everything, it was discovered that on the back portion of that, on the back side, was a very old building. And it was later determined that it was George Flint's house. And that is the area where they used to sell vegetables when Diane Downing and had the farm. So some of you may remember that. My wife reminded me that we were there often. Vegetables and They also had a very large area for picking strawberries. That's, of course, all developed now. That's all Dewey Drive coming down through. So after the fire, the house stood there for a few years. Once it was determined what it was all about, the militia was given permission to dismantle that, and then the idea was to rebuild it right on the property behind the Putnam Barn. In doing all of that, it was very interesting to find that most of the lumber that we saved, anyway, we stored underneath the Putnam Barn. Well, that was a mistake, because it sat there for a long time. And the beetles, out of post beetles, ants, whatever, got into it. So all of that lumber that we so diligently tried to save was not usable. But we did manage to save two or three of the very large beams and put those in there. The idea the militia had was to reconstruct it, originally using the old lumber. And once we found out we couldn't do that, then we said, well, that's when Gordon stepped up and he started a campaign to collect donations. We collected donations of about $25,000. And we had the frame actually erected by somebody, a professional firm. And then we did the siding. It was all done very, very similar to what it originally was. Now, what I'm going to show you here, I brought a model. Okay, I think you can all see that. All right, this was built by Jerry Levine. He was one of the members of the militia. We also have a second one that was built at the same time, unknown to each other, by Jim Stewart, who was also in the militia. Now, you see here, it's called a garrison house, and it was all framed, one big frame, right? This is exactly the way the current house is. However, it's very, very similar. The house that we rebuilt is more square. This is more of a rectangle. But it's the frame that you have here with the two stories. Now, with a fireplace in the back, all of the old homes are, not all of them, but many, many of them in the original days, face the south. They would get the sun that way, and the fireplace was usually on the back, on the north side. So that took up a lot of heat, so you heated the back side. Now, the interesting thing here that I want to show you is the lumber, the boards here, went from the bottom, from the frame at the very bottom by the ground, all the way up to the top. And right here, all the way up under the eaves too. When we took those original boards up, they were at least an inch and a half thick. Then they may have been even a little bit thick. So you, and they were wide. They were all at least a foot wide, 12 to 14, maybe 15 inches. So you can imagine how heavy they were. And so what they did with these is they put them up and down all the way around. Then sometimes they clapboarded the house. Sometimes they didn't. It all depended on, you know, what was available, the financial situation, whatever. So you see here the fireplace. Is in the rear. with the stairs that go upstairs, right? Everybody would have slept up here. And down here would have been the living area. It was the kitchen, dining room, living room, whatever. I mean, they had room. Wow, it all depended on how large the family was. Sometimes there were 8 or 10 kids. And being a garrison house like this, with very thick boards that protected them from Indian raids. So, in the early days, with a house as stout as this, any of the neighbors, if during an Indian raid or if there was an Indian alarm, they would congregate at this house. So I think that the interesting thing is that we discovered this through something that was a disaster for one person. It was a stroke of luck for the fire that had happened, but then we fortunately had plenty of people in town that recognized, looking at that old building, what we have. Any questions? Okay, I have this, I'll have it here. We also have a book here that is photographs of our restoration, which I will put on the table over here. And also a little notebook here about the restoration of the house with pictures and everything. So, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Gary, what year did you say that was built?
1684.
1684.
Before 1684, according to the book that I read, yes.
It's like my barn is from 8. I have, there's a map in the library with going back to 1875. And my barn is shown on that map at 22 Mount Vernon. The farmhouse is, I think, across the street. But that barn is constructed with posts and beams, pegs, and so forth. And the old, what they call the square cut nails.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Kind of.
There were no nails in this original house.
Yeah.
Thank you, Gary. Very nice. Thank you, Gary. Our next speaker is going to tell us about Looney Hill. You might even learn where the name came from. Let's see. It's going to be his name is Rex Whitmore. Sorry.
Hello everyone, I'm Rex. I'm 49 and I've been living here since I was 42, so that's 47 years. I don't remember much of those early years, but I grew up on Taylor Road, Maple and Taylor Road, up at the top of the hill. If you know a Mead Road, it crosses Oakdale. It would be, if you went up to the top, you would take a left and it would be down at the bottom. Right where Maple Road starts and heads towards Cherry Street. I'm going to talk a little bit about Looney Hill at first, and then I have a letter I'll briefly go over that was from my Uncle Alan Marini, who was born in 1924, and he lived here in town. Growing up at the top of the hill, well, when we were younger, back when I can remember, we had pretty much free reign as kids back in those days. You were allowed to leave your yard and actually go down the street without your parents following you around. And we did that quite a bit. I had a lot of friends in the neighborhood. Some kids were, their last name was Monday. I don't know if you might know them. They're on Maple Road. Maycumber, there was a young boy named Paul Maycumber I used to hang around with, chum around with. And Staffs, Michael Staff. And I'm trying to think if there was anybody else. Carlinas. That was, Carl's mother was an offshoot from the Holtz. Actually, her sister's here down there. Irene. So anyways, we moved around the area pretty easily. We loved our bicycles. We pretty much rode all over town on our bikes. Some of the stories I've heard when I was younger about Mooney Hill, and one of them that sticks in my mind to this very day is we used to go to Ryers a lot to get snacks and treats. And every time we pulled in the Ryers, Bill would go, "Here comes that Mooney Hill gang." Now, it took us a little while, a few stops in Ryers, and we all looking at each other, "What is he talking about? What is Mooney Hill?" So one time we went in there and we go, "Bill, why do you call us the Mooney Hill gang?" He goes, "Well, a long time ago, there was a gentleman named Mooney that bought the property up the top of the hill," which was, you know, basically the whole hill, which must be a real long time ago because my grandparents were there before I got there. And I think the term Mooney came because my grandfather told me that there was a gentleman that lived behind them that had a still. And back in those days, due to the still and the fact that, I guess, I don't know if anybody remembers Bill Warnock, he used to be with the fire department here in town. He owned a house that they say was previously a jail before he had owned it, up on Oakdale Road, which would be about just up the hill past Sherman Road on your left. And so they had two things going for them. They had a jailhouse and a still, and a couple of stories I heard that the police were afraid to go up there during the prohibition years because the place was called was loony up there. So that's another possibility where the name came from, at least from the stories I hear. I'll share one more story about when I was growing up. I was a paper boy in the morning. I used to deliver papers, and another thing the kids can't do nowadays. There was one person in particular I used to deliver the paper to. Her name was Mrs. McPhee, and she lives in a house that Steve O'Leary lives in now off of Mead Road. And she used to tell me little stories about, you know, the area, and I remember this one distinctly. She told me once that she remembers looking from her doorstep to the railroad tracks that ran along the Ipswich River and no trees in between there and there. So there must have been quite a few fields here in town back then. And I'm going to finish up by touching on this letter that my uncle wrote to my mother before he passed. He had moved to Florida when he got older. I'll try to make it quick. Growing up in North Reading in the late 1920s and the early 30s, my first recollections were moving from Central Street to Park Street at the junction of Winter and Park Street, opposite the railroad crossing and station. The station master and his wife lived next door to us. My mother drove the old Model T Ford, and my job was to sit next to her and hold the bird cage with a canary in it. They were building and remodeling the house. We had no indoor plumbing or electricity at that time. We had a two-holer in the shed out back. They ran in, some of this I can't understand. I think it's B&M, AM and ARM train from Lynn to Lowell and back at 5 o'clock in the afternoon. The train would stop right in front of our house. At the station, my sister Ann, about 7 years old then, would sit on the fence, and every once in a while, the conductor on the train would toss us a couple of candy bars, which were Milky Ways and Chuckles back then. Across the street on the railroad was a large meadow and cranberry bog. Martinsbrook and the Ipswich River joined right in that area. Let's see, some of it I can't read because of this writing's a little switch. Okay, and then the two rivers joined just after 28. They came down and they came onto the meadow. Every year during winter, it would flood. I could ice skate from Havel Street sometime, so he could ice skate from near where the train station was to Havel Street. They would put their skates on in the morning, skate to Havel Street, take the skates off, and walk from the Havel Street Bridge to the bachelor school. And then bring their ice skates and put them back on to get back home at night. The last house on Winter Street was the Browdy, I think it's B-R-A-U-D-R-Y-S, and his best friend was Eddie. And he writes how his father, Eddie's father, wasn't in too good a shape, and how he had to take care of the cows and the horses and all the work that they did taking care of those. He said he had two or three cows. And he taught, Alan got taught by Eddie how to milk the cows and feed the horses. And he goes, I don't know if anybody can remember. Eddie and I used to roam all over town. North Redden at that time was a bedroom and summer camp vacation spot for Boston and cities. It also was still a farming town with 6 to 8 good sized farms still operating and sending their produce to Boston Market on the weekends. Dan Latham's in back of us, and it's B-E-A-U-D-R-Y-S, was one of those. The Latham farm was one of the farms that was still in operation. I doubt if anyone remembered that at one time North Redden had an airport. Yeah. It was, you know where the power lines run from Park Street across 28? It was right between there, Park Street and 28, before the power lines came. Across Park Street and 28. To right of Park Street was a big open field. There was a big shed near Route 28. Oh, and the pilots from World War I slept there. They were parked their two-wing rotary engine planes, wooden frames covered with painted canvas. And on weekends, they would give rides for $5 over the area. At night, there was a golf driving range that operated then. When the high tension lines came, this is how you can tell where it was, through, that put an end to all that. Someone built the Middlesex Club on Route 28. That last I knew was called the Starlight. And then, Oakdale was known as Looney Hill in those days. Summer camps, a suspected still, this is where I get the still story. The town cop didn't dare go up there at times until Prohibition was ended. In the winter, we would slide down the hill, meaning Oakdale, and at the foot of the hill, they would have to take a hard turn into a field before they came out on the Park Street. And he goes on to say that they weren't too worried about going on the Park Street because there was hardly any traffic back then either. And then he said you could also coast down the hill from Richardson's the garage all the way down to the train station. What's that page? He walked everywhere. He walked every place on the road, bought bikes all over town, kind of like we did in the early 70s. Any house in town, he says, I could walk to any house in town, told you who lived there, from Middleton to, some of this is hard to read. From Middleton to Wilmington, from Reading to Andover. At that time, I was in the seventh grade. I graduated, graduated high school. It said something here about having to go in writing to go to high school. They would go to the bachelor school here, and then once they get to high school grade, they had to go up to writing. And then it goes on to say something about Reynolds Milk. He used to work for Reynolds Milk. And when the owner was passed away, he left it to him. But he was only 17 years old, and he couldn't bear to take it from the mother, so he signed it back over to the wife. And that's it. That's what he left. I have some pictures, a little map he sketched out about the area, and I'll leave them on the table here so everybody can look at them.
Thank you, Rex. Appreciate it. Our next speaker is Joe Long, and he's going to talk about Liberty Acres.
Okay, Liberty Acres. In the beginning, our family moved to from Chelsea to my grandfather's house on Gordon Road, 1943. It came with an outhouse.
Two-hole.
I only remember one. We lived there until my father finished building a house next door. And when we moved in, the heat in the house was a kerosene stove in the kitchen and a potbelly stove in the cellar.
I can hear okay.
No hot water. So on Saturday nights, my mother would heat water on the stove and fill the bathtub so we could have our weekly bath. At night, we'd also listen to the radio. Terry and the Pirates was around 5:15. Sky King, Sergeant Preston of the Yukon, and many more. On Sundays, we always listened to the greatest stories ever told. And Lowell Thomas in the news. Our father did not have a car, so on Sunday, a bus, McIntyre's or Lane's bus line, was provided by the Baptist Church, so they'd pick us up, take us to church, and bring us home. So that's why we're Baptists. In early spring, my father would bring home baby chicks, and he would put them in the upstairs hallway in a pen. And as soon as they were big enough, he put them out in the chicken coop. Some of the neighbors came from Newfoundland, like my mother and father, and moved to the Boston States. That's what the Newfies called Boston, Massachusetts. And they lived in Chelsea, Everett, and other cities near there. These Newfies, the men, were mostly iron workers or carpenters. Every 2 or 3 weeks, my mother would walk down to Route 28, a mile from the house, with one of us kids, and go shopping, take the bus to Reading and do the shopping until my father got a vehicle. Deliveries and services. During the week, we had deliveries of milk from Whiting's Milkman. I loved it in the winter time because the cream would freeze and pop that top off. Bakery goods were delivered by Cushman Bakery. Seafood from Jack Ellis. And my mother and father would love to order cheeks and tongues because that was a goofy dish. They knew we wouldn't need it, so they had it all at the same time. Canned goods were delivered by an old man in a truck, and they were dented Monarch cans. Ice for the ice box from the ice man. My mother would put a sign, a nice sign in the window, the front window, to the ice sign was up straight, so you could read it, and it was so many pounds, and then if you turned it upside down, it was another, and then side to side, it was something else. Ralph Douglas would collect the rubbish. And what he didn't collect, the people would burn in their backyard in a 55-gallon drum. The junk man would show up once a month, and the kids in the neighborhood would collect scrap metal and papers and would sell them to the junk man. And the money that we got from him, we would spend on ice cream from the ice cream man, or we'd ride down to he had a little store on 28 and Park. And she was diagonally across from McMillan's garage. We couldn't get ice cream there, but we'd get soda, candy, bubble gum, baseball cards, and whatever we could get. Let's see. The doctor. We never had to go to the doctor. He always came to us, unless it was an emergency. And many times my mother was the doctor. If you had a cut or you needed stitches, she would wash and put iodine or mercuricone on the wound, pinch it together, put a Band-Aid on it, and you were all set. I'll give an example. Mr. Penny had a small pig and chicken farm, and he would come around weekly and collect the garbage for his pigs and put it in a big bucket in the trunk of his car. One day I wanted to see what was in that bucket. So I put my head in the trunk and bam, one of the older kids slammed the trunk lid on my head. My mother did a procedure under my eye and you could hardly see the scar later on. Kids think, of all the seasons, winter was the best. We slid on the roads, down the hills, on our flexible flyers. In the winter, the Liberty Acres roads were always packed with snow and never sanded. We knew when to get out of the road because we could hear the chains clanking against the fenders of the car. One time we even tried to tried tobogganing and used a strip of metal roofing from an old chicken coop. It didn't work out well. Cut again. We skated on Murphy's sand pit. It was called the pond. I don't ever remember having a snow day from school. In spring, when the ice on the pond was getting thin, we would run across the pond to see if anybody could make it from one side to the other. It was only 2 feet deep, so. Other seasons, we played all kinds of games, Polly, kick the can, and roll the tire down the road and so forth. Mostly in the road. We played sandlot baseball where little school stands today. There was no organized sports back then for the kids. We made our own. Sometimes we'd go to the Wilmington dump where Shea's Concrete Products is today. And we'd use our slingshots to shoot rocks at bottles, rats, and other things and collect junk to sell to the junk bin. One day, a friend and I went there and we found two boxes of candy bars. We ran back to the neighborhood with the candy. I felt like Santa Claus and so did my friend. The kids were all excited to get free candy bars. We had a chocolate feast. Fun was had by all. When I was recalling this adventure, I thought of Sammy Davis Jr. singing, "Who can take the sunrise, sprinkle it with dew, cover it with chocolate and a miracle or two? The candy man, oh, the candy man can. The candy man can, cause he mixes it with love and makes the world taste good." The swimming hole. There was was an old swimming hole at the end of Liberty Acres near Cold Spring Road. We would hike up to the Cold Spring Road, down to an old gravel road, to an abandoned railroad track, where the bridge crossed Martin's Brook. One side of the bridge was shallow, the other side deep. It was about 20 to 30 feet wide. On hot days, we'd go up there, wade, swim, or play in the muddy waters. Most everyone came out of the brook with bloodsuckers on them. And we'd use sticks to hook them off. It was like something out of Norman Rockwell. I was young and couldn't swim very well, or at all. And spent most of my time in the shallow end. One day I said, all right. I decided to surprise the kids in the deep end. So I started wading from the shallow, under the bridge, to the deep end. The water was up to my waist, my chest, my neck. I stepped into the deep. I went to the bottom, came to the top, sank, walked up again. Seeing the yellow bubbles in water, the third time I came up, thinking, this is it. I felt someone grab and pull me out of the water. When I looked up, who was it? My sister Bob. Did you do that today? Blueberry picking. Also in the summer, when the blueberries were ripe, the neighborhood mothers would pack lunches and water and take the kids to the low blueberry patches under the high tension lines. We'd pick all day, day after day. One day it was hot as you know what. One of the ladies had a problem with a dress. What was it, Bob? What happened?
It disintegrated. It was kind of
her dress melted.
Oh!
It was the first porn we ever saw. Forest fire. One day in October 1947, I'll never forget, when billows of thick smoke darkened the acres for hours, our eyes burned, and we could hardly breathe. People came out of the houses thinking the worst. Later we learned that the smoke was from a forest fire that drove all the residents from the North Reading Sanatorium.
Wow.
It was pretty scary at that time. School. Ralph Spicer was our school bus driver. He would pick us up at the corner of Gordon Road and Park Street and drive us to L.D. Batchelder or the Campbell House. Anybody remember the Campbell House?
Yes.
And if anyone caused trouble on the bus, he would stop and make the troublemaker or makers get off. One day there was nobody on the bus. I remember singing songs or ditties to and from school, and one goes like this. There was a little Dutch boy, his name was Johnny Verbeck. He made the finest sausages you ever would have seen. Now all the neighbors' cats and dogs will never more be seen. They'll all be ground to sausages in Johnny Verbeck's machine. Oh, Mr. Johnny Verbeck, how could you be so mean? I told you you'd be sorry for inventing that machine. Why, would you hear me? One day the thing was broken, the darn thing wouldn't go. So Johnny Verbeck, he climbed inside to see what made it so. His wife, she had a nightmare, walking in his sleep. She gave the crank a heck of a yank, and Johnny Verbeck was me. There was never a dull moment on the bus. If we missed the homebound bus, for some reason, we would walk more than 3 miles home, or thumb home. There was no weirdos back then. If a car stopped and was full, you stood on the running board and held on until you reached your destination. Listen, recent visit to the Liberty Acres. I've driven through Liberty Acres recently and recognized the hills we slid on, the pond we caught frogs, turtles, and snakes and skated on, but I could not recognize many of the old homes. They have been remodeled or rebuilt. And in conclusion, I have discovered, this question is, have I discovered the mystery of how Liberty Acres got its name? And I have a document, a copy of a document, and I'll read it to you. It's a map or a plan of Liberty Acres lots. And on the plan, it says, plan number 3, Liberty Acres, North Reading, Mass., owned by Lynn Realty Service, Inc. Edgar C. Lynn, President. Chapin C. Lynn, Vice President. Their office. Lots divided and plan traced from 1918 plan. And it's a drawing of Liberty Acres, and it says, within 15 miles of 15 cities, Haverhill, Lowell, Waltham, Boston. And then it shows Route 28 and Park Street, and it says, electric cars to Lawrence. And on here are the plots, and some of them are 25 feet frontage, some of them are 50, one of them is 146. I must have been a minister. Middlesex Registry of Deeds, South District, Cambridge, Mass. Copy of the plan recorded June 30th, 1927, 12 o'clock. Has filed plan number 917A of 3. If the society would like this map, you're welcome.
Oh,
yes, please. Thank you, Joe.
It's a copy of a copy.
That's okay. Thank you.
And now that's the rest of the story.
Thank you, Joe. I didn't know you could sing. Next, we're going to hear from people to tell us about the Marblehead Street, and it's Eleanor Donegan and her sister Mary Conrad and John Watson.
Can you put the microphone down a little bit?
Yeah, okay. Put it down a little for you so that you can talk.
And come a little closer to the mic when you guys are ready.
Just tell us about living up there.
Well, really, we've been here since 1935. Mm. The family has been. We came from Italy. My father took us back to Italy. We were born here, but my father took us back to Italy in 1930 because of the crash. And so therefore, we were there for 5 years. And when we came back, it was 1935. So my sister Honey was born, and I don't know where she got the name Honey. She's not, you know. But anyway, she's a baby. She was a baby. And so therefore, we started here in 1935. And now, we couldn't speak a word of English. None of us. My father and mother could, but we couldn't. And my father had registered us to go to school first in 1935 in October. And the school said, well, they'll have to walk to the bus stop, which was about a mile away. And my father said, well, my three little girls, I was 6, Lucy was 7, and my sister Lena was 10 at the time, and of course she was only 3. He had said to us, the girls couldn't speak English, and so therefore he didn't want us to walk to the bus stop, which was a mile away. And so they said, well, that's the only way you're going to get to go to school. So that was October, and then it was November, and then December, and then January, and February, and finally they thought, I think we better send the bus up there, otherwise they're never going to get to school. So that's how we all started, the three girls, the three of us, we started, we were in the first grade right from then on. But Lena, my older sister Lena, who was 10, she'd gone to school in Italy. So she was pretty smart. And she went to the third grade at the end of that first 3 or 4 months of school. And then the next year, she went from the third grade to the fifth grade. But Lucy and I, my sister Lucy and I, we would stay together all through school years together. So that was one thing that we did in my thing. And my father had a farm, and we used to raise chickens and eggs, and we used to sell them, and gardening. And I don't know, back then, and John, can you embellish any of this here?
Back in 1935, Martha Street was hardly paved, and to send three little girls, a mile up the street to get a bus, and my mother and father thought about it, and they said, "I don't think so." So they kept the girls home until the town authority decided to send a bus down to get them. But those three little girls went on to graduate, went on to college, and two of those three little girls taught at the Aldi Bachelor School later on.
Oh.
My oldest sister was instrumental in setting up the home ec department at the Bachelor School before the high school was completed. So they did very well. So it was good that he kept them home until the bus finally went down to get them.
Honey, would you tell us the story about how your father got the land for the farm?
My father was here 3 years before he could finally buy a place for us to live. He worked, but I think he worked with Mr. Garman down the street, and so that farm became available. At one time, the farm apparently was bootlegging.
You know, we had several stills there, when we were there. We never realized it at the time.
No.
There's so many stories about that. We really wish we could find out how that came about, who lived there prior to when we lived there, and also how it was rather elaborate. By the time when we saw it, we used to play there all the time because we had a lot of land there. And yeah, it was interesting. People always thought it was ours, but we bought it with a still on the farm. And it was a very elaborate one. I mean, it was like in sections. And they used to draw the water, I understand, from Swan Pond in order to whatever they were making. But we never really knew anything about that still. Sure, yes, so
but I guess they got caught because of the trucks delivering the sugar. We had a very long driveway.
Oh, that
you didn't see the street.
How long was our driveway?
It was long.
Which we used to have to shovel. My father had all girls at the time. You
right.
know, he finally
right.
did get a son, but you know, that was long after we were gone, really. I mean, he was, you know, and so that we used to have to do all the shoveling of the, you know, because we didn't have a, you know, they didn't shovel the driveway, certainly, and it was a long driveway. So everything was done by three girls. You know, my father was working at GE, and when he wasn't home to do any of the chores, well, we did them all. So the gardening, and we used to, you know, have things that we would bring, and we would have, you know, vegetables that we would take into the market in Boston.
Mary, when they were developing modern Continental,
yes,
far in on that property, the remains, cement remains,
yes,
of those
yes,
stills
of
were all
dug
all
up,
in
were
it.
They?
Yeah, they were all in it.
Yes, uh-huh, right.
As a matter of fact, my father had a plow made years later from one of the big tanks that was on the still.
Yes.
He hired someone to cut the plow, and he had a V plow made, and so he got to use it anyway. But anyway, the federal government, I guess, took it over. And my father, I guess, got wind of that, and so living with the Garmins just down the street, he was able to buy the property. And that was in 1935.
Right.
That's when we came. And interesting, a lot of work.
And she was born in Italy. Honey was born in Italy in 1932.
Right.
Oh, I shouldn't say that.
Don't
tell. She was my favorite sister. But it was good. It didn't do us any harm. We worked hard. We very seldom, I mean, if we were going to go to the center, we were so excited because we never went to the center of town. We were always on the farm, you know. Very different people say, you know, tell us about the town. What can we say? We were on the farm most of the time working.
We didn't know anything about the center at all until
that. It was a good life.
What part of Italy was he from?
Cofino, central Italy.
Central, right.
On the Adriatic coast.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And we've been back several times. We should go back, you know, again. But see, he had a house there. That was the reason he went there in 1930. When the crash happened, he thought, well, there were no jobs in here, but they're hard to come by. And he had a place there to live in. So my grandparents were living with us at the time. So we went back to Italy and lived there for 5 years. And that's when she was born. And so then, but as soon as President Roosevelt was elected in 1932, he thought that would be the end of the crash here. And so he wanted to come back and he wanted us to live in America, certainly. And so,
well, thanks to him, he ended the crash.
Yes, that's true. Right. And so anyway, we came back in 1930. So he came back, and once he had a place for us to come to, then we all came back in 1935, my mother and the four of us. By then, we were four girls. And so that's, you know. And I remember coming back on the boat, you know. That's the last time I'll ever get on the boat. I mean, we were so sick. I was so sick. Yeah, we were. Yeah, in some of those days, I said, boats. But other than that, we've enjoyed our life here in North Reading, really. And we've all come back to it in some form or another. You know, I mean, I'm in Andover right now, but
I'm still on Marblehead Street.
Right. I know a lot of people that I work with here, because Lyman and Pat was Alice, and then Helen Mentis. Well, I call her Helen Mentis, but I know she's not Mentis anymore. Right. So
where on Marblehead Street is it?
Well, it's almost at the very end of Marblehead Street. It's quite a development up there now. The land is all built up.
On the Middleton end?
King's Row.
Oh, King's Row.
Right.
Okay.
That was the driveway.
Oh, that's, yeah.
Oh.
Okay. That road where it is now was the driveway.
Right. Uh-huh. Right in that area. Right.
How many acres were there?
There were 100 acres.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. And it's all been built up.
Yeah.
But there were a lot of fruit trees. It really was a wonderful place to raise a family.
Yeah, we could drive our cars around. My father had an old truck, and we could drive in there, but nobody, you know, because we weren't on the street, we weren't in the yard. And that's where we, you know, we learned a lot of, you know, gardening and that sort of thing. And we're still doing a lot of that ourselves, as far as just for our own personal life. But we had a chicken farm, we used to have pigs and,
sheep.
Yeah, sheep, right.
My father just was interested in farming.
Right.
So it was kind of fun.
And we used to have an egg route that, you know, we sold eggs to people that we knew. And we used to have to, wait, you know, it's funny.
Dress them.
Yeah. Right.
Dress them.
And yeah, right, we used to do all of that. So we were farmers, basically.
Didn't your farm, you used to have grapes and apples and peaches.
Oh, I did all kinds of fruit.
We moved here in 1966,
mm-hmm.
and what people call King's Road now.
Yes, yes.
We call the old dirt road, that's how we knew it.
That's right.
And the farm, your family's farm was gone by that time.
Yeah, that's right.
But we used to go down there and pick berries and find apples and...
Oh, right.
And
cranberries. Yeah, cranberries, we had a cranberry garden down in the backyard and then...
Oh, right.
Lots of cranberries all around and...
Huge trees, it was really great.
Yeah.
Right, right. That was our life in North Reading. And we enjoyed every bit of it. Every bit of it.
Very special.
Honey, how many houses were between the farm and Haverhill Street when you were there?
Probably, John, would you say within 10?
Yeah, probably.
Probably about 10. Yeah, and they were all related, so, you know, I mean, they...
The Stanleys? Were the Stanleys there?
Stanleys were there, right, Stanleys, and then there was the bus driver.
We had a wonderful bus driver, Mr. Stevenson, I don't know if anyone knew him.
That's right.
But he kept...
Oh, and Carpenter, that's right, yeah.
Oh, the Carpenter.
The Swensons, right.
Noseworthy.
Farrens?
Noseworthy, right.
Farrens?
Pardon?
Farrens?
Yeah.
Farrens, of course, Farrens, right.
And the Lords?
Lords.
Yes.
Well, that was it.
Wasn't there an Evans family?
Yes.
Scooby Evans.
Oh, that's right. Did you know them? Yes, of course, of course.
Yeah.
See, those are the people we knew, you know, those are the only ones we saw.
I think you named everybody in that.
Yeah.
They're really spread out.
That's right. But there were probably 10 houses from one side of Mount Elizabeth, all the way to the very end. So yeah, it was interesting, but we enjoyed it all. But we did some, we had to go to Wakefield. My sister lives in Wakefield, the one who taught here in North Reading, that sister, yeah.
But getting back to Mr. Stevenson for a minute, he was a great guy, and he owned the bus. And he lived about halfway down the street, Joan. And he would do all his shopping. He'd take the kids to school and then go shopping. Or if he had fruit trees, he'd have apples. And he'd have the apples, he'd pick them and put them under the seats. Well, you know what happened once the kids got on the bus, the apples went flying. You know, he was the greatest guy. During the summer vacation, he would take one day and take all the kids on his bus route to Canopy Lake for the day, free. He was really a great guy. Kids didn't appreciate it, but I did.
So that's our story.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right, I came a lot later, 46.
Okay.
I'm like, yeah.
You're a lot, yeah.
But my mother was Italian, and so there was a guy, Mr. Schwein, I live on a dirt road way at the end. You go into Middleton and back into North Reading.
Okay.
So he was a friend of their father's.
Right.
And so that's how I got to know them. So I knew plenty from when I was like born.
That's right.
Yeah. Exactly. See? So when I came, the house I live in now is the same house, but it was a two-room camp that apparently they'd been moved from the CCC camp in the forest, and they moved a bunch of them up on my road and out in the Middleton part. So it was only two rooms, and it had no plumbing, no electricity. Outhouse, I guess, I don't remember that part. There was no water. But they ran a cord, because we were over the town line, it was the county line too, and they couldn't get electricity. They just couldn't do it. They finally, somebody went to the State House in 49, so they were there like 2.5 years. And used to run an extension cord to the house next door, which was in Middleton. It was like 150 yards. So all I could run was like a light bulb. You know, I remember a little kid and the light was like pink because it was barely any juice. And we still had an ice man. We didn't have any electricity. So, you know, I counted the houses, I remember from the 50s, there was like 28 houses on Marblehead Street all the way into Middleton. But 16 of those houses got ripped down in what we call progress. And now there's like 100 houses, not even counting all the side roads. There was one road, Cottage Street, was the only road off Marblehead Street. And now there's 9 roads off Marblehead Street. So it's changed quite a bit. Like they said, we didn't, you know, we just rode our bikes and roamed all over the place. Apparently being like 10, 11, like 5 kids with 2 guns. They had like a 410 shotgun and a 22, and we walked all the way down Marblehead Street and Forest Street shooting squirrels. And nobody even cared. It was like, nobody even, people would go, hey, there's a squirrel in my front yard, you know, nobody even, if you do that now, you'd be like, on the news, we'd be taken away from our parents. They were like, yeah, okay, yeah, they got guns, they were all right. They I didn't have a gun, but I was there.
The older guys.
Yeah, the older guys. They were like 12, 13. So that's about, so I've been here, well, off and on, but I've been back since 80. It's changed a lot, but it was fun. We knew every single person.
That's right.
In Milton, Forest Street, and all the way down Marblehead Street, you knew every house and every dog. Everybody had a dog, and you knew every dog. It's changed a lot. Yeah, there was 4 chicken farms and a mink farm.
Yeah.
All the
on Marblehead Street.
Yeah, mink farm. That's true.
Yeah. So we had Stanley. Yeah. We had more animals than we had people in the whole town.
Mr. Rainer, who had a property, he had cows, he was a milkman.
Yeah, the milkman.
Yeah. Walter Carpenter, I'm sure a lot of people remember Walter.
Yeah.
Walter Carpenter, he had a little place where he used to teach, he used to give horse riding lessons, because I never was there, but, you know, it's just a lot of different things.
Yeah.
The street has changed so much.
It was so twisted. There was crashes on Stanley's Corner.
Oh, right.
Like 5 a year.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
people would go around that corner, they had a big stone wall in the way, and the road went whipped a lot more. And there were hills you could make yourself like roller coaster, jump off the seat. Everybody would do it all the time. And on Stanley's Corner, at least 5 crashes a year.
Oh, yeah. Easy.
But they straightened it out, took all the fun out of it.
I know.
I figured out once that if I went one trip a day since I've had my license, I've driven over 70,000 miles on Marblehead Street. That's all I got.
Very much. You know, John, we've been trying to get these ladies to come here for the last number of years, right, Lyman? And it took John to get them here to speak to us.
That's
wonderful.
We really don't have much to say.
It was very nice. Very nice. Vicki Johnson is going to talk to us about Martin's Pond.
Can you get the microphone?
First of all, John and I were in first grade together.
We're not that old.
My family moved from Somerville to Hillside Road, North Reading, which is on the Route 28 side of Martin's Pond. My dad's name was Howard. My mother's name was Ruth. I was the middle one of 3 girls. I was 4. My sister Karen was 6. Linda was 2. And my earliest memories of the pond is just having my mother take us down to the edge and teach us to swim. You know, we would just go across traveled way, go right down, and you know, it was kind of sandy and the water was nice. And so we learned how to swim. And like other people were saying, the bloodsuckers, the turtles. My dad would have the rowboat and we would go fishing on the pond side, the perch rock side. The ice cream truck came by. the fish truck came by, the Hood Milk, I think it was Hood, but it did was the glass bottles, and it did freeze in the winter where the cream came to the top. We used to have a lot of sleep outs. We'd just tip over an old like swing set, cover it with blankets, and there'd be four or five of us under there sleeping out. We'd take turns, okay, roll over, and I'll scratch your back, okay, roll over, I'll scratch your back. And it was so much fun. Oh my gosh, there were tons of kids on that side of the pond where I lived. The Campbells, the Carters, the Murphys, the Parsons, the Westovers. I mean, it was just tons of kids. One of the places we used to play was at the ice house. We used to play like pickup baseball, softball, and that was great. That was great. The ice house was our bus stop. Louis Eisenhower was our bus driver, and he was tough. If the kids acted up, he stopped the bus, grabbed them by the collar, they were out the door. Oh my gosh. We used to do a lot of sledding because Hillside Road kind of came down, and Coxwell came onto it, Alston came onto it. When I told my sister Karen, who's the older one, that I was doing this talk, and she said, well, I remember sliding down Coxwell Road and breaking my arm because there was a tree right at the foot. We used to slide at the top of Alston Road and could go all the way to the pond. I mean, it was great. It was wonderful. There were a lot of ice fishermen, and I remember skating and falling into the ice holes. I remember used to have bonfires on the pond. They would sometimes, you know, after Christmas, they put the trees out there and the ice was thick enough to burn. And one of my friends says, well, remember they used to drive cars on the pond. Crazy. My own family, we had 12 cats at one time, so we used to put the cats in doll clothes and stroll them around the neighborhood. I remember when we were young, I think it was Hurricane Carol, and I would have been like 5, 6 or something. We had no electricity, and we had this little fireplace outside, so we were cooking outside on the fireplace. Just cool. We used to ride the bus to Reading to go to the movies, and that's when there was public transportation up and down Route 28. We used to go to Reedy's store. It was the gas station and the store right there on 28, because that's the place we could get candy bars and Coke for 5 cents, and that was great. That was so close. That's probably why we all had cavities. let's see. Somebody told me there were a lot of bars around the pond. And not that I remember Don's Cafe, but that used to be right there where the public boat ramp is. And I guess, you know, people used to frequent it. And this lady, Lois, that lives across the pond, was saying, well, when the pond was frozen, this fellow who lived on the other side of the pond would walk across to Don's Cafe. And he did it most of the winter until one time the pond wasn't safe enough and he drowned. And then I guess there was another club on Lakeside Boulevard called the Pond Club, and somebody else told me that their father used to walk across from, you know, my side of the pond to the Pond Club and wondered why they never got sucked up in the water. used to shop at the Atlantic, and that was there, where Stop and Shop is now. And the sunsets on my side, because I'm on the east side, and oh my gosh, the sunsets are spectacular on the pond. Just spectacular. Like I said, we had tons of kids. My mother lived in the house till 2 years ago. I moved away to go to nursing school, and I came back to the house 4 years ago, and I've been redoing it. So that's been my story. And ironically, she died 2 years ago today, so this makes me think of her. So, any questions?
You mentioned Louis Eisenhower's bus. There was another Martin's Common bus. I think they called it Polk's Road. Do you know where that was?
No.
I think it was also driven by an Eisenhower.
Yes, there were three or four brothers.
Yeah, that ran school buses.
Yeah,
that's true.
It was fun. We had a ton of fun. We could walk from almost the boat ramp down to where Chuck and Carucci's family had a beach, sandy beach, and they used to have a little candy and ice cream store. But you could walk right along the edge of the pond, all the way down. And now people have fences and you can't. The other place we used to swim a lot was at the, called the Wallamans. That's their, the family name, but they were the first ones to have a motorboat. And oh my gosh, we all got to try out the disc, you know, just go on the pond and then try out the water skis. I mean, we thought we were just so terrific. And they had a raft, and we were always tons of kids swimming down there, and they did such great work keeping the beach sandy and weeds out, and just making it fun for the kids. Yes, my sisters and I are very happy that we grew up there. We loved it. We loved it. My friend Pam, Denny, you know, she moved to town when we were like fourth grade, and so I've been friends with her forever, you know. So any question? But one thing I read, that people were called Ponderonians. I never was called a Ponderonian. But I do remember there was a little stigma attached. Well, where are you from? The pond. That little stigma, like we weren't quite good enough. But we all turned out good.
Thank you, Vicki. Our next speaker is Ben Sands. I've had him down as speaking about the center, living in the center, but I don't know if that's what's going to happen.
you didn't tell me that this was the comedy hour. I'm not quite prepared for that. I would like to, I've made so many damn notes here. So many different people and so forth that I know, I can't help but recognize. Who's this guy? Right?
I know it.
Scarlett, I pick him up every month to go out for dinner. I tell Gordon when we meet for dinner, and I pick up Lyman and I drive him across the street. To go where we go for dinner. And I say, by the time I get across the street with him, I've been laughing all night. He just tells stories. I do have to kind of recognize some people. I know that Eleonora looks a lot younger than I do. But we were classmates. And it is true that we didn't see a lot of you during your high school years. And we, and people at school would say, where's that cute girl from up in North Reading? And Joe was asking about you, actually.
Oh.
Another good Italian boy. I'm going to jump around here. I did have a silver story, one of our classmates. And her family moved out to the pond back in the mid-40s or at some point. And she had the same experience, and she moved here. As she tells the story, she moved here and went up on the top of one of those hills and Hillside Ave or whatever behind the pond. And she said, I thought I was in heaven. And we moved into, this is her words, we moved into a shack. And we had woods, we had a pond at the bottom of the hill, and we were in heaven, and we loved it there. So, you know, beauty is in the eyes of the beholder in that case. Talking to Vicki, the Crosbys, am I not correct that Mr. Crosby, who did our hair, was Tut? Wasn't it Tut Crosby?
Guy Crosby.
It was Ted.
Huh?
It was Ted, but
no.
Yeah, but yes. We call
Wendell.
Him Tut.
Well, Guy Crosby is somebody
else.
Ted Crosby. Wendell.
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 Yeah, but we call him Tut.
I don't know.
T-U-T.
Well, whatever.
Is that right? That's what I...
Mary Chapp was still there, by the way.
And I happen to tell a story about Mary. This goes back to us buying our property. We have a camp up in New Hampshire. And I was doing some campaigning for Fred Keyes. So that would go back, let's see, we both had records like in 1966. Yeah. And the last call I made, or I was up on Marblehead Street and I was making calls the night before the election. And I came to Mary's house and, talking to her about that we're going to vote tomorrow, blah, blah, blah. She said, did you know that property on, neither one of us can think of the person's name, that was selling their property up in Melbourne Village, and Mary had a place up there. And I said, no, I don't even know what you're talking about. And she said, it was right next to the door to that place that you used to rent. Well, when you rent a place, you never go next door.
It was a candy store, wasn't it?
Well, she had a little bakery up there.
Oh, so,
But anyway, we ended up buying it, and that's where our family is up there now all the time, and it's been this thing that's brought our family together. This goes back to 1972, so we've been up there for 28 months, that's 43 years, and all because she told me that thing was for sale. We bought it, we put a, not a bid, we put our name in because someone had an option on it, and she sold it to us the day after the option was up. We drove right up. I didn't even have to do anything. This is the place we wanted. Some other notes. Joe, you mentioned something about porn. P-O-R-N. I have a little joke here. One of my jobs, I had two different jobs when I was a kid. One was with Harold Upton at the Lumberyard. I also mowed Harold's lawn. And he was very tight with a buck. And I think the pay was about 30 cents an hour. And he'd pay me by the quarter hour. I'm not joking. I mean, if it was 3.5 hours, you got 3 times 30 and 15, and you got $1.05. Anyway, I also worked with Public Works Department. And I think maybe my father was a selectman. He got me a job there, during the summer when I was a 16-year-old or something. And had guys like Bobby Campbell and Gilly Barr and one of the Wheelers, pretty rambunctious group of guys. And actually, Dick Spindle was just starting to work at that point. Dick was a year older than I was. And had gone back to school, and it came Christmas time, and the guy said, why don't you come down to the barn Park Street, come down to the barn, for a little Christmas party. That was my first experience with porn. I don't quite remember the theme. But it was the, I couldn't tell my father about it. I said, just, you know, being a selectman, I can't come home and tell him. I just saw it at the time of shit. not exactly what...
was that the year the state police came?
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe they did. Might have been a year after or something. I see Dick Ham here. I was in Dick Ham's wedding. I was one of the ushers at his wedding many moons ago. And of course, I've known Joe and Barbara and Dave and a lot of people here. What I wanted to talk about a bit was my best friend in Northridge. And he is, I'll read this stuff to you a little bit. He has to go down as the most accomplished, in my mind, the most accomplished person that's ever gone through the North Reading school systems and the Reading High School systems. And that's a guy named Joe Fermani. Dr. Joe Fermani. I'll read to you what my wife, I'm very bad at medical terms and so forth. Joseph Fermani graduated from North Reading High School in 1915 and went on to Harvard and then to Duke. He went to work at the National Institute of Health and Cancer Research. In 1969, he and Dr. Lee, L.I., discovered a generic link to a rare form of cancer that strikes children and young adults. They were the first to discover a genetic link to cancer, and a lot of research then has been based on that discovery. The syndrome was named the Lee-Fermani syndrome, and anyone connected with cancer research or genetics would recognize his name. I can tell you, in going around over the years, if I've ever been with people, for instance, the new president of Tufts University is a geneticist, and when I got a hold of him, Tony Monaco, and I said, Tony, would you happen to know a guy named Joe Fermani? And he just kind of looked at me like, of course. You know, I know Joe Fermani. He's famous. You know, he's a internationally known geneticist and so forth. He was the director of, I have to read this one too if I'm understanding, director of the Division of Cancer Epidemiology and Genetics at the National Institute of Health. He had 350 geneticists, research people working with him. One person actually was from North Reading. Most of you that knew the Rex family, one of the Rex girls, worked under Joe at the National Institute of Health. If you ever, Joe asked my wife and I to come down when they had his retirement party. It was 2 years ago in May. If you ever want to feel like you're at the bottom of the gene pool, you should go to a symposium where they're having someone like Joe retire. It was just an experience that everyone that spoke was the president of this university, this medical school, this, that, or the other thing. It was just, you know, incredible to go through that and hear people talk about him and how incredible that he was. When he had the final retirement dinner after the symposium, and we go over there and Judy and I are sitting at his head table. I'm sure everyone in the room would say, who are those two people over there sitting with Joe? It's like the old joke about who's that up there with the Pope? But it was just an incredible experience, and we have, you know, used him. He became, a direct link for us in the family. One of my daughters had breast cancer, which she's a breast cancer survivor, and I can remember calling up Joe I just talked to him last night for a long time, telling him I was coming here. And he had a couple of questions I'm just going to throw out. But I asked Joe, I said, okay, we got this situation, what do you want to do? And he said, well, first thing you should do, I know where you are right now, but you should get into Boston. And I said, okay, how do you get into Boston? What do you want me to do? He said, I'll give you a call tomorrow morning. So he called me back tomorrow morning. He said, can you be in the lab at 2 o'clock this afternoon? And I said, yeah. But anyway, when he was talking to the person that was in charge there, obviously, he'd go right to the top, and she said, I'd take her case, but she said, I'm going to be on a plane tonight flying to Paris, and we're going there for a symposium of some sort. And she said, one of the subjects is your syndrome. So that you know, that just tells you how big it is. But it was fantastic. You know, my daughter got in there, gets an appointment, gets the top person, and you know, she's doing great today. A couple of questions, and let's see if someone can answer these. One thing, Joe, he mentioned a couple of things to me. One guy he talked about was Lino Lindsay. Lindsay was the coach of all the sports at the bachelor school when I was there. That's 1946, 47, 48. And I think, well, first of all, I think Lino thought that I was a little Jewish boy from Chelsea because he always called me Bernie. I never crossed him, I didn't really care. but Joe remembers him, that he taught all the sports, and he also did some stuff with the Boy Scouts. And he said, the only thing I can remember about, Joe liked to talk to me, because he could talk to me like he couldn't talk to anyone, but, you know, with all these geneticists around him, he's just a scientist and stuff like that. And he said, all I can remember is we did arm wrestling and Indian leg wrestling. Now, I don't know what Indian, anyone ever heard of Indian leg wrestling?
You never did that?
Indian
leg.
Lay
on
the floor opposite each other.
You gotta live with this, Gordon? You gotta live with Gordon, right? The other person that he mentioned, actually, Joe usually liked to talk to you about old girlfriends. So when we get through that, he talked about a Mrs. Trott. Now, Mrs. Trott lived beside him, in between his house and Mrs. Foster. And she was a whistler. And he remembers going down to the Congo church to hear Mrs. Trott have a whistling thing there. Anybody else remember that?
I know her name was Ruth.
Huh?
I remember her.
Well, you remember?
I remember.
No,
Ruth,
okay.
Husband was Howard, but I never heard her whistle.
We remember whistling. Maybe you were too busy whistling at her.
That house, it's right where they knocked that house down about 6 or 7 years ago.
Oh, is that right? All right. Well, that's what I have to say about the Senator time. That was my best friend. We had a great time. He and Denny Conner were my two best friends. And, yes.
Well, they go, people in town would know where Joe grew up, so.
What's that?
They would know where Joe grew up, so would you tell them exactly where he,
oh, what
the
house
that was still?
Yeah, he's, when I moved to town in 45, and even though that wasn't that long ago, when we drove from Stoneham, I never even heard of that. It was North Reading, two towns away. You know, and kept on going driving. I think I was driving to Maine or something like that. but I lived in the house right in, next to Downs's, the three pillars in front. It's all yellow now, taking all the trees down.
Crerys house.
Yeah. We bought it from Rodney Crery.
Yeah.
Right, and then he moved across the way there and so forth, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then my father built the house in behind. And at one point, he almost, some way or other, was going to buy the land in front of his house, which is now part of the park. So that was good that he said not to buy that.
Are we talking Chestnut Street?
Hable Street. Yeah, so he...
The Frasers, the Supernats.
Lived in the house, it was like an Italian villa.
Yeah, right.
Italian style. They didn't build it. They moved there in 41, spring of 41.
Yeah.
And Joe thinks that it was probably built only about 2 years earlier. By somebody.
His mother was a musician.
And his father used to be the guy that rode as Paul Revere back then. He was in the ancient nonboat and rode in the Columbus or
Patriots
Day.
His mother was an opera singer. His mother was an opera singer.
Oh, really?
Pauline, yeah.
Pauline, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. She sang with us when we had the Jubilees in
Norway. Oh, is that right? Yeah, I didn't know that. Yeah. I spent a lot of time at that house, and Joe spent a lot of time at my house.
Really?
We were very, very close, and we remain very close now. We talk very frequently. His wife always says, you know, he loves hearing from you and stories, you know, from North Reading, because he doesn't get that from the people that he's generally associated with. So I can give him a lot of crap.
Ben?
Thank
you. I think it was Ted Crosby.
Ted, that's what I was saying.
Yeah. Oh, thank you.
Thank you, Ben. That was very good.
Can I just say something?
Yes.
Ted Crosby is my great-grandfather-in-law.
Oh, really?
All connected. That's scary.
Yeah, we all went to get a haircut. I don't know what it was.
25 cents.
What, 20, was it a quarter?
Yeah,
he worked at the Boston Black and Company. That was his regular job down at BB Chemical, but that was his weekend.
I think it was Wendell, but I think we probably did.
Yeah, that's Ted,
right.
Was
that's
that?
Right. Yeah, Ted is right.
Our next, how are we doing for time?
Yeah, you're okay. Getting kind of tight there.
Our next speaker is Roy Walters, and Roy's going to talk about a portion of the first meeting house.
Oh.
Do you want me to hold anything up to you?
Well, first comment, after I heard the story about the stills, the born, and all that, I don't know if I should have moved here or not. But here I am. Now, I know everybody in the room is familiar with the meeting house. I'm not going to talk about when and when it was built. It was the first building where it had town meetings in 1717. And Tom Parker's done a lot of research on it, but I'm really here to talk about what we're going to do with it now in 2016. And I'm a member of the Minutemen, as Gordon is, and as you know, we've participated in these other buildings here, there, and in the Putnam House ground. So in the past, when we restored or installed new buildings, for instance, the Farm Museum being new, we followed this particular method. We generally raise private money and use generous business fund donations, labor and product donations by Minutemen, citizens, and several local businesses. And always, all our efforts and donations are acknowledged by letter. Everybody that donated got a letter of thank you. And their names on a plaque at the site for each building we've done. But for the meeting house, we're starting different. We're starting with grant money is available to us, and also a shorter deadline. We're trying to do it within a year. Otherwise, we'll follow the same money raising schemes like generally by Gordon Hall and his large yes. So let me tell you what the progress we've made on the planning. We approached Historical Society, and they gave us the tax number in January this year and approved our move. We visited the Historical District Commission in February. They approved the location. And I have an enlarged picture of this also, but this is different. This is a picture taken by a drone.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. House
can be an aerial photo?
You can see the farm museum, schoolhouse, Flint house. There's your Putnam house. And all of that was taken one day by Al Pereira and this drone for us. And this is the location where we're going to put the meeting house. And I got a large version of that. Basically, the idea is the meeting house will be placed about 10 foot of the property, north of the property line, perpendicular to the Flint House aft end, and facing the shoe shop. That's pretty much the scale. It's 17 feet wide by about 35 feet long, if I'm not incorrect. So that location has been approved by the district, and our goal is to place it there. So how are we going to get there? In December, Gordon advised us of a group, the Thuan Festival of Trees Preservation Project. We approached them. We submitted a proposal in December. It was approved in mid-March. And the proposal was aimed at incorporating residual beams from the disassembly of the meeting house in 2014, and then inserting them in the new post and beam structure. Now I'll show you a post and beam structure a little later. The funds are going to be available April this year to April 2017, payable by them to us upon the receipt of the work. One interesting note, and one thing I'm pretty proud of, we won approval amongst 22 submitted proposals for our job. So, technically on the building, the meeting house is disassembled in 2014, and all the materials are saved in the Putnam House barn basement. And slow that one. That one, yeah. Now, most of you from last month when I talked recognize this is post and beam building. It's not as clear as picture, but anyway, it's beamed up this way, assembled, pegged, to hold it together. So our proposal says from beams left over and saved from the meeting house, we'll put in here and there. And we also have one beam which already selected to be used in the corner. And Gordon called it a gunstock beam. And we all know what a gunstock beam is, don't we? Anybody?
We don't.
I don't, so anyway. So anyway, the estimated cost that we submitted to the Festival of Trees was $3,450 for the post and beam structure, plus $600 for a crane to put it in place for $4,050. Our project plan is to have a contract with Mark Tree Hall to purchase the structure and install it at site. And the reason we've done that is the people at the Festival of Trees noticed in our proposal to use Mark Hall's name or company. And they made the assumption that we're going to follow it, that we're going to have a contract with them. From the Minutemen to Mark Hall to do the work. So, now the Festival of Trees people have requirements for their support. We'll have a sign donating their support on site, newspaper articles, or any public information has to recognize the Festival of Trees participation. I've already talked to Dr. Rose about being in the paper soon. And what we've done, like we've done in the past with buildings, periodically, 1 month, one per month, one every 6 weeks. This is where we are. Notice, recognizing people in the group and the progress. So the other present activities, right now we're putting a request for bid from a postal meeting builder. Gordon Hall doing that. Gordon and I did our first review and selection of potential beams to use as a structure. And also preparing a statement of work for Mark Street Hall Company. So in summary, we're on the way now with excavation, putting plans in late April, early May. You never remember the guy that does excavations. Tell me his name.
That's Bob Snyder.
Bob Snyder's done lots and lots of work for us at minimal cost and continues to do grading after the things are in place and supporting us. But he's taken the gall to go to Florida for vacation. So anyway, when he comes back, the promise is we're going to start. The goal is they haven't done my apple test. It's less than a year. Now we did the farm museum in just about 2 years, starting with nothing. So now we have about 16% of our money on hand, and a plan, and a location. We're ready to go. So that's the summary of that. Now, another little comment I'd like to make. At the district meeting, somebody was asked, what do you guys provide, an empty building? And I thought about that. And in the past, all restored our new buildings, such as the farm museum, we furnish the rooms with appropriate period furnishings, and we will plan to start that effort after more research for the meeting house. And another one, this is too narrow one. And we as Minutemen always represent our various projects at open houses by providing speakers who describe and answer questions by visitors to the facilities. So every Apple Fest, or when we have the Christmas tree lighting, or when children come down to the schoolhouse, most of the time you'll find a Minuteman there describing it and bragging about it. So, I really want to thank you for your attention. Thank you for being aware of what the company of Minute Militia do. And we've been doing this since 74, I guess. We're 42 years in organization. And on the order of 10 of us now, with sore ankles, bad backs, what have you, we're still building buildings and still cracking away. So thank you, and I'll take any questions. And I know the cookies are waiting.
Do you want to show them where the building came from?
Yeah, that was the first one, Gordon.
I have a picture.
So way at the back.
Eden property, the assessment tree.
Yeah. I think we all know where it came from. From Sydney Eaton's?
Oh, yeah.
No. Should be.
Yes, Chestnut Street. Close to Upton Avenue.
Yeah, that's now we take that one. And that's what's
yeah,
started.
I know. Way back.
Sometimes I would recognize the trains that. Yeah. And there was one side that. This part here that you have now two spelled. This must be a home.
Yeah, that's all that we put up there.
It is getting late. Okay.
Thank you very much, Roy. Well, well done.
Thank you.
Do we have time? Matt Romeo would like to say a few words. Do we have time?
Well.
It's late, huh, folks?
Pat, can you talk in 3 minutes?
3 minutes, Pat?
Not really.
I know,
I told you we need a whole program with you. We do.
Yeah. What about two stories?
Well,
pick two, just two.
I don't know if I can do that. This story is not about any present selectmen that are here tonight, but it is about a board of selectmen and a dear departed member of this group, Barbara O'Brien. We were at a selectmen's meeting one night at Town Hall when it was over here in the center of town, and it was a hot, hot middle summer night. It must have been 90 degrees, and those big arched windows were open, and you never know what's going to fly in when those windows are open at night. And so, sure enough, in the middle of the meeting, a bat flew in the window. Well, you never saw five men screech. They all screeched, and they all jumped up, and briefcases went everywhere, and papers went everywhere, and the town administrator got up and ran into his office. There was a glass window in his office, so he was inside, slammed the door, and watched everything from inside. He wasn't going to get warned. So he's in there watching the proceedings. One of them jumped up on his chair, because I don't know what he thought, he was going to get attacked from below or something. He was okay. Somebody else was trying to get a broom, and he thought he'd swat it. And, you know, they were flinging papers around, and they were a wreck. And Barbara and I are looking at each other and said, what the heck is the matter with them? So, anyway, she calmly got up. The thing had landed on the jamb of the window. So she, it was the time probably in the 70s when the bell-bottom pants were in vogue. And women had these kind of flared bell-bottom pants on. So she got up and quietly walked over to the window and put her foot up by the bat, right beside the bat. And the poor little bat, who was probably traumatized by that time with the noise that was going on, and it crawled onto the pant leg, and now they're screaming even more. And she took her folder, and she very carefully gave it a little bit of a shove as she put her foot out the window and gave it a nudge, and it flew off into the darkness. And they all took a giant sigh of relief and sat down and tried to look composed as if nothing had happened. And she sat down and smiled at all of them and looked at them like, you damn fools. And that was the end of that. And Barbara had the upper hand after that, let me tell you.